Aviation has always been a love of mine. My dad worked in the aviation industry, my mom consulted for the aviation industry, and I always just loved the feeling of taking off and going to a separate country. 100 years ago, there was nothing of the sort, and now commercial flights are everywhere, and people kind of take it for granted that we can go from Paris to Japan in less than a day. The aviation industry has always kind of been an inspiration, and so a while back I looked into decarbonizing the aviation industry, understanding what is the problem with decarbonizing such a booming sector. And what I realized is there are a lot of ways of decarbonizing the aviation industry, but I wouldn't really understand all of them if I wasn't on the ground working on them. So I reached out to a ton of aviation companies. All of them came back to me and they were like, yeah, you're not 18. There was one aviation company that really believed in me, and it's called Cert Center Canada. Essentially what it does is it accelerates the certification of new and innovative planes. It works directly with eVTOL companies, SAF companies, and different hydrogen plane companies, and looks at how they can get their planes, stuff that isn't regulated yet, stuff that hasn't even been on the market, stuff that is transforming the aviation industry. How do we get that from zero to one? That is what Cert Center Canada does, or I like to call it 3C or CCC. So I worked on two projects with CCC. The first was a hybrid electric plane service that would be set up all around Montreal. They want to set up a service around Montreal that is powered by aviation, since Montreal City is one of the biggest aviation hubs in the world. And so they wanted to set up different services around Montreal that was powered by aerospace. And so I recommended them a deck that they've seen quite a few times. They've given that to university students, but they thought it was incredible. They thought it was one of the best they've ever seen, even though they give this to universities like Western, Waterloo, and UFT. The second project I worked with them on was they want to apply a certain sensor to the wind turbines industry that was normally used in the aerospace industry. I worked on both of those projects and had amazing results. And I'm so grateful for this company believing in me, giving me actual real world problems and projects that they're working on, and then delivering on those projects. It was an absolutely amazing growth experience. And so what I'm gonna show you right now is the presentation I gave for setting up different Montreal services that are powered by aerospace. I basically designed a hybrid electric plane service that would work all around Montreal. Yesterday, I presented to some of the most influential people in the aviation industry, some of the highest ranking executives you can find in all of Montreal, and then getting feedback on how we could actually implement this hybrid electric plane service around all of Greater Montreal. Okay, so thanks for coming, everyone. I'm Theo, and for the last 6 weeks, I've been working extensively with Cert Center Canada on two projects. The first is bringing the EAPM sensor to the wind turbines market, and the second is what I'm going to be talking to you guys about today, which is a service I've kind of pioneered or thought about, which is Montreal Connection. Let's get into the problem, the solution, and the impact, and then go deeper on how are we actually going to implement this solution. So essentially, the problem is that highly congested areas in Greater Montreal make it so that just-in-time delivery systems are delayed and Montrealers who are traveling lose productivity. So a lot of people who work in Montreal or, you know, do anything in Montreal live outside of the island, so they have to move through highly congested bridges. These highly congested bridges mean that trucks sit idle in traffic, which means that certain services or certain products or cargo can be delayed, which can hurt a lot of businesses and hurt productivity in general. The solution is an interconnected network of transportation systems that is powered by the aerospace sector. So I'm thinking of a hybrid electric plane service that could take you from different places in Greater Montreal to the Montreal metropolitan area. And the impact would be this transportation network will drastically improve the public transit system for people who live outside of the city, reducing congestion in a meaningful way. So just to give you an idea of the vision, I'm thinking of an interconnected Quebec, connecting Quebec through different airports and through different aerospace services. and an all-in-one platform for Montreal transportation. We'll go deeper on that later on in this presentation. At first, one thing that I realized was it doesn't really matter where, like, what you do. It really matters if you're aligned with the government and the industry directions. And so a lot of themes and methods that we'll see in the industry is the themes is eco-mobility, electrification of transportation, aerospace transformation, pandemic recovery, and remote communities. And the methods are collaboration for innovation, inspiring young people and a young person attractor, training and mentoring, attract big programs, and SME growth. And so whatever we'll be talking about in this presentation has to align with those themes and has to align with those methods. So what's the problem? So I've defined about three core economic opportunities that come from Montreal transportation. The first is interregional migration. The second is commuting issues, and the third is cargo and delivery. So interregional migration. From 2019 to 2020, Montreal saw 62,900 people leave the Montreal metropolitan area to settle in different places in Greater Montreal and Quebec. Different areas in Montreal are expected to grow by 15% over the next 20 years. So think the Laurentians, Estrie, all these different regions in Greater Montreal. The second economic opportunity is commuting issues, right? So just to give you an idea of how big the commuting issues are for public transportation, about 10% of people who live on the South Shore take public transit. So most people just don't take public transit. They move through highly congested bridges. And this creates problems with cargo, right? So cargo and delivery systems, as we mentioned, as trucks sit idle in traffic, that can delay just-in-time delivery systems, which force businesses to expedite parts. And if we just look at the Associations du Camionnage, they say that 87% of businesses suffer the effects of delays in just-in-time delivery. So if we can address all three economic opportunities, we can have a lot of impact. So just to give you an idea of how big the demand is for Montrealers who are traveling outside of other regions in Quebec or interregional migration, 1.2% average population growth for zones adjacent to Montreal from 2020 to 2021, a 2.56% migratory deficit in Montreal from 2020 to 2021, 78,500 people left Montreal from 2020 to 2021. The Laurentians and Estrie are expected to grow by almost 20%, Laurentians with 21.3% and Estrie with about 17%. And if you compare that to Montreal, Montreal is expected to grow about 3.1%. So it's very minimal, and all these different regions outside of Quebec are getting a lot of traction. So it's great to look at statistics, but I was on the ground interviewing customers, and so I thought a great place to start was Kahina. She's a good friend of mine, and what I realized was that it's not just a problem that you see in statistics and you see on the news, it's a problem that people are facing every day. So Kahina is R&T and Sustainable Innovation Senior Lead at Airbus, and before that was Head of Eco-Design and Environmental Affairs at Bombardier. So she says that the challenges for commuting are outside of the island of Montreal. Most people working in Mirabel face this challenge, and they need to either co-travel or to buy a car. There is no other alternative. For our intern at Airbus, it is a big challenge. So she's seeing a lot of problems, how there is no public transit system that can help people get from Greater Montreal to the Montreal metropolitan area. And I interviewed another person, and her name is Natalie Moslin. She works a lot with human resources. So she was a human resource director at Studium Craft in Montreal. Before that, she was also working at Beyond Technologies in Accenture. So she has a customer story and also a business perspective on this. So for her, she lives on the West Island, and she has to commute about 45 minutes to 1 hour every day to get to work. And so I used to take the train before it was shut down by the REM being built. Before that, the train service was terrible though, and now there is no public transit system that lets you get from the West Island to Montreal. And not just like a personal perspective, but she's also seen a business perspective. Looking into human resources, she's seen a lot of problems with acquiring talent. So she says, location is extremely important for recruitment, especially if it's manual work and can't be done remotely. there were absolutely candidates that we lost because they didn't want to commute from, for example, Laval to the South Shore. So there's a lot of problems with commuting issues, not only in businesses with acquiring talent, but also for just personal experiences and personal customers. So what I'm proposing is what we call the platform. And essentially what we're going to do is we're going to have a hybrid electric plane service that works. Essentially, you're going to go from different airports in Greater Montreal, and you're going to be connecting through two hubs, the Saint-Hubert Airport and the Montreal Trudeau Airport. The reason why we chose both of those airports is that they're both connected to REM. So essentially you could go from a Greater Montreal Airport, you could fly into Montreal Trudeau or Saint-Hubert, and then you could take the REM to the Montreal metropolitan area, or you could do the opposite. You could go from downtown Montreal, take the REM, then go to, you know, Saint-Hubert Airport or Montreal Trudeau Airport, fly from Montreal Trudeau to wherever you wanna go in Greater Montreal. And so the platform is aligned with government trends. So eco-mobility, it reduces emissions on road, less cars in traffic, less problems with just general emissions. Then electrification of transportation, it's a hybrid electric plane. We're trying to electrify the aviation industry. Aerospace transformation, so transforming traditional views of aerospace and public transport. And then pandemic recovery. So this is attracting a lot of young people, because if you see hybrid electric planes, I just think that's awesome, right? That's kind of where I'm thinking right now for the platform. And I'll show a little bit more in the technical depth. What we're thinking is a series parallel hybrid electric plane. This could carry about 60 passengers and about 10 tons of cargo. We're thinking of using reluctance motors. And we're thinking of afterwards in 2050, around that, we're going to leverage the power of hydrogen. So maybe a turboelectric hybrid configuration, or just a hydrogen plane, so a solid oxide fuel cell. So we'll start with hybrid electric planes, series parallel, but then slowly convert to hydrogen, or maybe even hybrid electric hydrogen planes. So how would this work? So essentially what we would do is we would start off with two airports. The main hub, which would be Saint-Hubert. The reason why is because you could take the REM from, you know, the Montreal metropolitan area. You could go from the REM to Saint-Hubert, and then from Saint-Hubert you could fly into Mirabel Airport. Why Mirabel Airport? Well, Mirabel is not connected to the REM, that's the first thing. And the second thing is that there are a lot of big companies in Mirabel. In particular, we have Airbus and Mitsubishi. And Airbus has already had its history of air shuttle services for their employees. So in Toronto, if I looked at some of the statistics in Toronto, but there were air shuttle services in Toronto for Airbus employees. And so if we just bring that to Montreal, it just makes a lot more sense. As well as Airbus is working on hybrid electric planes, so it just makes a lot of sense to start with Mirabel and places of that sort. So we'll start with about five hybrid electric planes that will fly from Saint-Hubert Airport to Mirabel Airport. And as we continue, we're going to continue to expand. So the green circles are the ones that we would open up, the stations we would open up 2 to 3 years after the initial station, so the starting station. And so essentially we would open up Saint-Jérôme Airport, Montreal International, Mirabel Airport, Montreal Saint-Lazare Airport, Saint-Mathieu-de-la-Prairie. So the green ones would be the ones we would open up first. And then after 4 to 5 years, we would open up other ones in the Greater Montreal area. They define the orange circles, right? Now, obviously, the main goal is to have a connected Quebec. So after 2050, our goal is not just connecting different places in Montreal, but having a completely interconnected grid of hybrid electric planes that will fly you from different places in the Quebec area. So essentially what I'm thinking as well is to add an application to all this. So what would it look like in principle? Let's say 10 years from now, the hybrid electric plane service is working. Well, what exactly would that look like? So we would have an easily accessible service. So an easy to use application, making transportation seamless. The application helps create an interconnected network of transport. So essentially you would fly from Saint-Hubert to Mirabel, and then either take like the REM to Saint-Hubert and then to Mirabel, right? Now let me show you an example of, let's say, Kahina. She works at Airbus, right? So her main thing is in Mirabel, right? So let's say after Mirabel, she doesn't want to take her car. She can go to Mirabel Airport, and from Mirabel Airport, she could fly into Montreal Trudeau. Then from Montreal Trudeau, she could take the REM and then go to McGill. And then she could go from McGill to Angrignon, right? So this would be an interconnected network of systems where you could use this application to book different flights, to take the REM or to take the Metro and plan out your entire public transit journey through Montreal. So what would flight times look like? So we're thinking about, there's about five planes. Each plane would have a total of 20 flights back and forth. And so essentially you would start maybe like one plane would, this is about two planes, so it's just giving you an example. So maybe one plane would fly from 5:30 to 6:30, one plane would fly from 2:30 to 3:30. So we have different flight times for different passengers and what passengers need. And we're also gonna be very flexible with these flight times. So it might work like a bus service where maybe at 2:30 there's not that many passengers, but you need a lot of cargo, so you'll take a lot of cargo and not that many passengers. But maybe at 6:30 you have a lot of passengers, so you just like fill up on passengers and not a lot of cargo. Maybe at 8:30 there's not that much cargo, there's not that much passengers, so you just wait until the plane fills up and then you fly, right? So we're gonna have a degree of flexibility, but this is just an example of what flight times would look like for two or three planes in the Greater Montreal area. So let's think about costs. So in terms of capital cost, we have about five different variables that I've took into account. For R&D, research and development, we're gonna about 200 million over 2 years, right? The design will be about 500 million over 5 years. The certification and testing will be about 500 million over 4 years. The training will be about 50 million over 2 years. And the production, the cost of production, three per year, would be about 25 million per plane, right? So this makes our capital cost about $1.26 billion in upfront costs, right? And then in terms of operational costs, so every year we would have to pay technicians about $9.9 million. This is because we want about 30 technicians or 30 maintenance workers per one plane. If we have five planes, that's about 150 workers. And so 150 workers paid an annual salary, that's about $9.9 million. The pilots would be around, there would about be around 30 pilots for five planes flying at different times. So essentially, one pilot would be about $200,000 a year, right? That's their annual salary. So that's about $6 million. The maintenance, getting all the parts, fixing all the problems, all of that type of stuff would be about $75 million. And then the landing fees, getting from Montreal Trudeau, Saint-Hubert, all that type of stuff, that's about $27.7 million. So your total operational cost over 1 year would be around $118.6 million. So why do we think this would work? Well, we think that the government will help us a lot because they have already shown interest in interregional migration. We've already seen things like the government giving subsidies for the airfare program. So this is a program where remote regions, you can pay $500 or less to take a plane to different remote regions in Quebec. And so the government has already shown interest in interregional migration. And so what this shows is that we can kind of stretch the amount that they can give us in subsidies. We're thinking we should aim for about 15% of the project to be funded by the government in capital costs. So what are our four main revenue sources? The first is tourism, the second is monthly passes, the third is upfront tickets, and the fourth is cargo. So tourism, there's a lot of tourists that come to different places in Montreal. Tourism is a pretty booming industry in Montreal. And so I was thinking, if hybrid electric planes become a big thing in Montreal, it's kind of like how people take the train in Switzerland just to take the train, right? It's an amazing public transport system. So a lot of people will pay upfront tickets, tourists will pay a lot of upfront tickets just to understand the interesting public transit system that Montreal will have, or the interesting transportation system that Montreal has. So we're banking on tourists paying a lot for different flights all around Montreal. So maybe $100 to book a flight 3 weeks in advance to have an exclusive tour of Montreal. We're also thinking of having seasonal passes. So let's say in Les Laurentides, there's a lot of people who really want to go to Les Laurentides during the summer. So essentially we'll have like different seasonal passes where we can fly you into the Laurentides, or maybe during the ski season, there's different people who might want to go to Mont Tremblant or different places like that. So we're thinking of making a lot of money off of tourism. The second is cargo, right? As we mentioned before, a lot of businesses have to pay 10 to 100 times the price to expedite a lot of imported parts for their manufacturing processes. If we sell our Montreal Connection business as kind of expediting parts for a cheaper cost, we can make a lot of money off of cargo as well. Now, monthly passes. We're thinking $200 for one monthly pass just to use Montreal Connection. And then we're thinking $300 for all of Montreal's public transportation system. So this is using the app that we recommended. This is using the metro, the REM, all of that type of stuff. So we're kind of saying $200 just to use our thing, $300 to use all of Montreal's transportation system, plus the app we've designed to use Montreal's abundant public transit system. Then about upfront tickets, we're thinking about $20 per ticket, so one ride would be equivalent to about $20. So what's our key cost drivers? So as we mentioned before, our CapEx is about $1.26 billion. Let's say 15% of that is paid by the government. That's about $1.071 billion. So over 30 years, which is usually the lifetime of a plane, you're going to have about $35,700,000 a year that you have to pay in capital costs. In operational costs, we've already defined that about $118.6 million we have to pay every year. And then the total cost per year would be around the capital cost per year plus the operational cost, which is about $150 million per year. Let's say we want to make over that and not include profit margins. What we'll have to do is we're going to have about 60 passengers per flight, right? And there's about 5 planes, right? So 5 times 60 times 20, which is about how many times the planes will fly. That's about 6,000 passengers a day at max capacity. Let's say 6,000 passengers all have a monthly pass, that's about $300. That's about $18 million. Then you include upfront tickets on that, that's about $20 million a year. These are very conservative estimates, but let's say $20 million a year in monthly passes and upfront tickets. Then in cargo, we'll probably be making around $50 million a year. And then in tourism, we're thinking of making a lot through seasonal passes and seasonal things like that. We're gonna have about $80 million. So $80 million plus $20 million plus $50 million in all of that will be enough to pay over the key cost drivers. Now, obviously, either we'll have to up some costs or lower some costs depending on how big the demand is for a service like this, as well as these are very conservative estimates. So we're thinking of also helping students. We're thinking of having a premium for students. A lot of times university students will have trouble getting to, for example, McGill University if you live in the West Island. So a lot of university students don't have a car, don't know how to really drive yet, so they're having trouble getting to their school or their university. So if we can help out students, not only are we incentivizing the economy because students are kind of the bread, like the lifeline of our economy, but also we're incentivizing the government to give us more subsidies. And so $10 for an upfront ticket for students and Montrealers who want to use universities, right? So our timeline for this is about, we're gonna have R&D from 2023 to 2025. Then the design will take about 2025 to 2030. The certification and the testing will be 2030 to 2034. The training and the testing will be 2034 to 2036. Opening of the first station, 2036 to 2038. Then in 2038, we'll have our 5 new stations, our 5 new airports. Then from there, we're gonna be keep opening stations around Quebec and around different places in Greater Montreal. And by 2050, we expect we'll have a fully decarbonized hydrogen system. So I wanna thank Phil, obviously, for giving me this internship. And I really wanna thank John as well for mentoring me through all of this. And I really appreciate you guys' time. This was an incredible experience learning about the aviation industry, and thank you guys a lot.
Afterwards, I got roasted by some of the highest ranking executives in the aviation industry. And one thing I realized was they are not going easy on me. I am not a kid. A few things that they said was focus more on tourism, as a lot of the numbers were matching up more with tourism than like commuting issues. And it's much better to go with seasonal passes and tourism than it is to go completely with the commuting stuff. Another really great point that was given by one of the Pratt & Whitney executives was the last mile problem. Essentially, maybe you can fly from, you know, Saint-Hubert to Mirabel, but then afterwards, how are you gonna get the cargo from Mirabel to wherever it needs to go? Are you gonna take the train for that? Are you gonna use a truck for that? Like, you need to take into consideration the last mile stuff and what's gonna be the last mile. Are people gonna walk with the cargo? Like, that's impossible. Are people gonna walk there? And then what if you land in Mirabel Airport, but your thing is about 30 minutes away for a walk? It's a last mile problem that is very, very difficult. And so maybe you could have like an Uber system that could work for that, where you have an Uber pick you up, or some sort of last mile solution to that where you don't need to worry about walking for 30 minutes or having trouble with that. So a lot of really great advice to implement a system like this, and it was honestly an absolute blast. So I want to say thank you to everyone.